Hello, I'm Smita Tharoor, and welcome to Stories of Unconscious Bias, a podcast where I ask guests from around the world to share their story and to reflect on their life experiences with unconscious bias. I hope you enjoy listening. They were recorded globally under COVID-19 lockdown conditions. James Baldwin was talking with Margaret Mead about identity, race, and the immigrant experience. Their conversation is still entirely relevant today. Baldwin says, "We've got to be as clear-headed about human beings as possible, because we are still each other's only hope." More recently, Michelle Obama spoke to new graduates, offering advice with a powerful, moving speech. You can find it on YouTube. She said, "Treating people right will never fail you. Selling falsehoods and blaming others for your own shortcomings, shunning those with less privilege and advantage, is a heavy way to live." But how do we do that? It is great that we are finally talking about racism and that black lives are being valued. But we need to be talking about more than simply black versus white and racism. It is about us as individuals, our narrative, and our own experiences that fundamentally defines who we are. History, society's expectations, the culture of a nation, where the power lies, and how it's wielded. That power doesn't have to come from wealth or class. It could be the manager in an office and how they treat their colleagues. It's about how we look at a person and make a judgment based on something that may not even be as obvious as black versus white. Listening to these everyday stories on unconscious bias is even more relevant today, as it helps us all to realize that we are not alone. We can reflect on this, and as Michelle Obama says, create the chance to leave this world a little better than you found it. Thank you for listening. I'm delighted to introduce Nitin Soni, CBE, composer, producer, and multifaceted polymath, who engages with the arts in every conceivable way through the filter of music. You've probably heard his music in one guise or another, whether as a soundtrack in a film, a standalone album, or in collaboration with somebody else. Welcome, Nitin.
Hi, how are you doing? You all right?
Yes, thank you. So, Nitin, unconscious bias. What do you understand by those words, unconscious bias?
I guess unconscious bias is kind of acquired or learnt kind of thinking that that comes from being in a climate of bias or inequity being normalized. So, for example, that can be regarding anything from race to bigotry of all kinds, whether that's sexism or any kind of bias at all. And that can be replicated in all kinds of behavior. So that can be an infection almost, so that unconscious bias actually does breed bias in other people too.
That's actually very powerful. And the fact that you chose the word infection makes it, and especially considering you and I are living in coronavirus times where the world is under infection, it's a very powerful imagery that I think everybody who is listening will understand, that it breeds and it grows, and then other people believe that it's how it should be, and then it becomes a new normal. So what does that mean to you then personally, Nitin? Because you must have so many different experiences. I mean, can you expand a little bit on that?
Absolutely. I mean, in every walk of life, I think we encounter unconscious bias, particularly as Asians living in the UK currently. I mean, I think quite often a lot of people who voted for Brexit were guilty of unconscious bias. I think a lot of what's happened, what happens with the way in which we've accepted a lot of racist perspectives on social media or through the mainstream media even is actually about unconscious bias. I think it's where people believe that somehow this is acceptable or normal to feel or to feel justified in their perspectives on race that are actually in reality powered by inequity and I guess exacerbating inequity. So I suppose, I mean, when we're when we're thinking, I mean, one of my experiences, for example, I mean, apart from the extreme racism I encountered when I was a kid, was when I was nominated for a Mercury Prize award in 2000. And I remember walking into quite a big record shop at the time, and there were 12 nominees for the prize, and I was one of them. But only 11 of the 12 were actually put together in a rack that said Mercury Prize nominees. And I said, why isn't the Nitin Sawhney record there? And he said, and the shop assistant just said, oh, well, he sells out of world music. I said, but you have a rock album there, you have a classical album there. Why not the Nitin Sawhney record? You know, that's just another category then, if you're categorizing it in that way. And he said, well, no, sorry, he sells out world music. I didn't say who I was. He just walked away. Now, the point is that this is kind of very much an indication of a lot of attitudes within the music industry. I mean, another example I just mentioned recently on social media, in fact, just yesterday, was I saw that there were 46 composers, film composers, on a top agency, and only one of them was a person of color. Now, that doesn't in any way meet the kind of demographic of the pool of people who play music or write music or anything like that. So you can tell from just the statistical data that there's definitely been some level of unconscious bias involved. And I think that happens with the way in which artificial intelligence is working now. We're perpetuating these same ideas and the same old ways of thinking that are outmoded, but we keep perpetuating them even when we're creating new technologies and new systems of analysis.
I was cringing when I was visualizing you in that record shop in 2000. And of course, you then went and won, and that silly fool who hadn't put your record out would be himself.
I didn't win that year, actually, but I won quite a few other things after that.
Well, of course, I mean, I know you as Mercury Prize, winner, and I didn't announce that when I introduced you because
I'm saying I didn't win, Smita. What happened though was it was very interesting what happened. One of the judges, I won't say who, walked up to me afterwards and said, are you disappointed not to have won? And I said, no, I was felt very privileged to be nominated at all. I'm very proud of that fact. He said, well, actually, you should be a bit upset because the reason, and he said, I'm going to tell you this. He said, the reason why you didn't win is because they'd said, first of all, that Talvin Singh had won the previous year. And I said, what you mean to say because one Asian person had won the previous year, they couldn't make an Asian person win the following year? He said, basically, yes, they didn't want to give it to another Asian person. I said, well, that indicates that the whole prize in the first place in terms of Asians is tokenistic. And he said, exactly. And I said, well, that's shocking. I'm disgusted by that. And there were, you know, that was something that genuinely happened that year. Now, I've sat in many panels since and been a judge, and certainly that's no slight on the Mercury Prize. It may have just been a situation that emerged that he may have interpreted that way. I wasn't in the room, but this person told me that at the time. So my point is, it kind of does leave me with a feeling of, well, what exactly happens in those kinds of situations, and who is actually checking for unconscious bias? I've been the chair of many panels since, and actually sat as a judge in quite a few panels since. And I always make sure to say to everyone, look, we need to kind of take this into account and make sure that we're thinking in an equal way. And I've encountered one person say to me once, oh, no, you're just kind of making it geared towards favoring Black or Asian people. And I said, well, do you understand the idea of inequity, you know, which is where where you need to actually address the intrinsic inequalities that are in society in the first place? And so you have to take that into account. You can't just walk in and just say everyone is on a level playing field, because they absolutely are not. And that's why you have you know, film agencies with 46 composers where one of them is a person of color. It doesn't work to say, oh, we just need to be to treat everyone the same. That doesn't work. That's why, for example, the All Lives Matter, that hashtag of All Lives Matter compared to Black Lives Matter, that's why there's a problem with that, because it actually doesn't deal with or address inequity. And that's where unconscious bias actually really comes into play.
I completely agree with you, Nitin, and I'm really appreciative that you've mentioned that. And this is not something that has happened only today or in the last few months. This has been going on for a very, very long time. And in fact, I think in, certainly in relation to music, I'm sure you know the story. I think it might have been the New York Philharmonic Orchestra who was finding there were not enough women in their orchestra, and they decided to have a curtain to recruit, so that when they were recruiting for the orchestra, they could not, it was genuinely blinded, they could not see the people. So much so they even asked them to come in barefoot, because depending on how you walk with shoes, and women might wear high heels or something else, so you could tell the difference. So you could hear nothing other than the music played. And then they were hired. And the number of people who, the number of women that then joined that orchestra, and I could be wrong that it's New York Philharmonic, but it was certainly one in the US, exponentially raised. But that, I mean, and that I think they continue to do. They do what we call blind recruitment, literally behind a curtain. But in the real world, when there are the judges sitting around, but I think perhaps in music, you might be able to do blind judging, where you don't know the person's name, you don't know their color, you literally just listen to the music. And then perhaps Nitin Sawhney would have won.
The difficulty is when you... Well, that would have been wonderful, but the difficulty is when also there are all kinds of other unconscious biases going on simultaneously, and one of which was, you know, the fact that I do incorporate Indian classical music, that, you know, that's why they put it in world music in the first place, which is actually a label that I find, you know, is very much a ghettoizing label that is designed to create segregation within record stores at that time. But I think on top of that, I mean, to address what you were saying about misogyny or about sexism within, you know, particularly within the music industry. I mean, I actually, a few years ago, I was very lucky to be and privileged to be nominated, shortlisted for an Oscar for my score to the film Breathe. And I remember seeing there were about 160 nominations, and out of them, 5 were women. And I put this up on social media at the time because I felt that as a man, it's an obligation to point this out when you see it. And I think that the problem is that when people who are being discriminated against through any kind of unconscious bias, when they draw attention to it, people perceive it as bitterness, or that they are in some way jealous or frustrated at not being chosen. But it's important. It's therefore very important, as somebody who is chosen, to actually highlight when there is unfairness and when there is injustice in the way that you know, that a whole list of nominees are being selected.
Yes, and because you are a person of influence, at least you are able to do that, because that is the power of people of influence. It doesn't matter whether they gender, their race, or anything. But when you see unfairness, people would hear you and listen to you more, and that's why it's so powerful that you do it all the time. And you know, I follow you on Twitter and Instagram and so on, and I read your tweets. So I think it's very important that people like you can, suggest how we can see the world and accept and the differences in the world without suggesting that people are shouting for the sake of it. And of course, what's going on in the United States today is an example of that. But I mean, tell me a little bit more. Yes, go ahead, Nitin. Go ahead.
No, I was going to say, I mean, the difficulty gets to a point where unconscious bias is endemic in society. You know, where do you draw the line? Because, you know, people will then turn around to me if I point out the fact that we have a prime minister here who talked of pickaninnies and letterboxes, and, you know, has a track record of racist comments. When we have a prime minister like that, and we and I point something like that out, I will be invariably met with cries of, oh, you don't understand democracy. But the thing is that actually the democracy of the fact that he was elected by an overwhelming majority shows how endemic unconscious bias and racism, in fact, blatant racism, is within society. And that's why it needs to be addressed. But the difficulty arises when our leaders, when the people who are actually shaping the attitudes within society or the media, are guilty of phenomenal amounts of not just unconscious bias, but blatant racism too.
No, that's absolutely right. But the thing is, it's endemic. It's like an infection, as you were so wisely said earlier on. So for us, it's just you and I, little people by ourselves. I mean, you're not that little, but you know what I mean. However much influence that you might have as a human being, how is it that we are then able to try and address unconscious biases amongst other people? Because there will always be a majority group who might not agree with you. But there would be surely other people who would agree with you. So what happens then?
Well, you start with education and with engaging with institutions and with society in every way that you can, and by calling out racism every opportunity. So, for example, recently I've become chair of the PRS Foundation, which actually awards money to for development of new music. And, you know, certainly we've had a lot of conversations on how to make sure that the awards address inequity and inclusion. And in the same way, I think it's important to constantly engage with society if you have a media platform like I do, a social media platform, or that you also are thinking about education. I mean, I sit on quite a few educational boards. And I work quite a lot with education. I've taught in schools and universities, but it's important to kind of do talks as well. I mean, I'm actually going to be doing a series of talks when all of this is over, about life as an immigrant or life as a musician from an immigrant heritage. And I think it's just about constantly highlighting those inequities and those problems and actually, you know, also making suggestions that are positive and celebrating immigrants here, for example. I mean, you know, my next album is called Immigrants, and it's actually a celebration of the history of immigrants, but also an expression from immigrants and people who sympathize with immigrants in relation to how they've been treated by society. So I think it's very important to kind of address all of those levels of discrimination and unconscious bias that exist across society at every chance you encounter.
Maybe I'm wrong, but you were born and brought up in the United Kingdom, or did you come to the United Kingdom as a little child?
So I was born and brought up in the United Kingdom. My two brothers came from India with my parents. Yeah. But I think the point is that, you know, someone from an immigrant heritage, you know, that's my point. And I kind of feel...
I deliberately wanted to... Yeah, go ahead.
No, so please continue. Yeah.
No, I deliberately wanted to flag that up because often people think immigrant means... you know, for example, I'm an immigrant to the United Kingdom. I was born and brought up in India, and I moved to London in my 20s. And of course, I'm an immigrant. So they'd say, but then why is Nathan calling himself an immigrant? Because he was born and brought up there. And what does that then say about unconscious biases in the country that you were born and brought up in? Because you still see yourself as an immigrant because you came...
I don't. I see myself as of immigrant heritage. So I would distinguish in that sense. So I would say that I empathize and sympathize with the whole journey of immigrants from one place to the other, and what happens with the whole aspect of trying to migrate from one place to another. So having seen and also, you know, the fact is that you wear the color of your skin in a racist environment, or in an environment that is actually constantly discriminating against immigrants. You wear the color of your skin like Jews wore the Star of David in Nazi Germany. You know, if you're, you know, where I was growing up in Rochester in Kent, I was surrounded by extreme right wing, an extreme right wing party called the National Front. And so, you know, the color of my skin marked me out. As it didn't matter whether I was an immigrant or from immigrant heritage. it was the color of my skin that they saw and attacked, which is, you know, which is why I wrote an album called Beyond Skin rather than Beyond Heritage or Beyond anything else. It was actually the fact that your skin color will be the first thing that people encounter or will see. So it's kind of, you know, people, there is no logic or rationality to prejudice or discrimination or hate. It comes at you with any justification it can find. And I guess whether that's the color of your skin or whether you come from an immigrant heritage or whether you're an immigrant is immaterial to people who are looking to perpetuate stereotypes or attack you.
No, that makes complete sense. But of course, both you and I also have unconscious biases of our own. So, I mean, have you sort of looked back on your upbringing and perhaps what maybe have you acquired any infections along the way which you perhaps not noticed in terms of unconscious bias, or perhaps it's now conscious, and maybe when you were 15 years old it was an unconscious bias, but you're now aware of it as an adult?
I think I probably had responses to the way I was treated by people around me, and I didn't really see I mean, it's interesting because I probably had an inferiority complex in many ways that was down to the fact that I somehow felt that I couldn't be good enough. And I think that I bizarrely kind of had my own unconscious bias about being from an Indian background because of the fact that, first of all, I mean, if you take history, history was taught at my school, even though it was a grammar school. It was taught in relation, I mean, you know, we'd learn all about European history, American history, Russian history. But if we were addressing India or Africa, we learnt about slavery or colonialism. And that was the prism of how we understood the contribution to world history of India or Africa. So my whole point is that I did not challenge those enough at the time. I felt it just made me feel awkward in class, where people would turn to me and say, you know, and make a joke of that. I didn't have the knowledge or the education or the skills to be able to respond to that at the time. So I think over time I've actually had to learn. And in fact, in the therapy, when I go into therapy, I've had to learn to accept myself as a kid. Because as a kid, I didn't accept myself. I felt very very inferior to other people around me, and in many ways, I felt that I wasn't good enough because of the fact that I had an Indian heritage, and that was how people made me feel at the time, by constantly beating me up, by attacking me, by making me feel inferior in class, by making jokes about me. I never had any real sense of identity that allowed me to come through, apart from through music. So music was my refuge and sanctuary against all of that. So the unconscious biases I had were actually replicating the biases around me, because those were the only people I knew.
No, and it's about keeping safe, isn't it, Nitin? Because when you are being attacked, the only thing you want to do is not have that experience again.
Exactly.
So you do everything in your power to keep safe. And you do it completely implicitly. You don't even take that long to think what you thought. It takes me less time to come to that conclusion. And, you know, just hearing your stories, you know, I feel I was lucky that I grew up in India and came in inverted commas fully formed, for want of a better word, because you use the word identity, and the idea of identity means so much. It's a small word, but it has so much meaning to it. And I remember coming to London in my 20s. But fortunately, it was in the 80s when racism against, you know, Asian people were dying down considerably. If I had grown up as a teenager in the 70s in London, I'd have no idea what my biases would be today. But I remember talking to friends, South Asian friends, people from, people who've been born and brought up in London like you, and hearing their stories and feeling very grateful that I had my own sense of identity. And the power of what that gave me, you know, feeling comfortable in one's own skin just because. Whereas, of course, you were not given that opportunity. And it took you a while with external help, like a therapist and so on, to actually learn to be comfortable with yourself again, which is an amazing, very, very moving story. So thank you so much for sharing that, and really appreciate it. But going forward, I mean, you've talked about education in terms of trying to improve ourselves, and certainly you fortunately are an influencer and you can go out there and, you know, talk about the different experiences and get people to understand. But what about little old people like me, where we don't have those opportunities? How do we manage our unconscious biases or learn to become aware of that? What kind of advice can you give us?
I think it's just reversing, I find, is a really good way to do things. I mean, for example, if you were to say something to somebody and then in your mind you were to reverse it the other way around and say, well, what would happen if the other person, you know, if I was in the other person's shoes and being spoken to like that or being treated in that way, would I find that okay? And so I quite like juxtaposing or reversing roles in situations where you might consider whether you have any unconscious biases. I mean, one example was when, I mean, years ago, I was in a program called a comedy series called called Goodness Gracious Me, and
oh, yes.
And there was one sketch called which we'd kind of talked through. I mean, it was called Let's Go for an English, and the whole idea was,
I remember it.
Quite well. The whole idea was about looking at the fact that, but it, I mean, it was a fun thing to do. But it was looking at the fact that every time we would go into Indian restaurants, we would see a lot of the white people who would walk in, absolutely mocking the waiters, mocking the food, being really unruly, being inconsiderate, making sexual innuendos to the waiters, doing all kinds of stuff that was quite disgusting and really loud, so that no one else could really enjoy their meals. And this was something we'd notice a lot in Indian restaurants. So the idea was to reverse it round. And I remember so we called it Let's Go for an English. So it consisted of a lot of Asian people in London then going for an English meal in a restaurant and doing exactly the same thing. And I remember the following day, a cab driver who was driving me, he recognized me from the sketch, and he said, you know, you really made me think, because I hadn't actually considered that I've been like that myself in restaurants. He said, I never really looked at it like that before. And I think it's actually about, looking at ways that you can reverse situations and consider them from the other person's perspective. It's just basic human empathy, really. And I think but I think there are techniques for actually, you know, making sure that you use empathy to understand another person's, you know, issues with things that you might say or do. And I think it's very important to even get language correct. The word inclusion, I think, is a very good word. I think, you know, there are certain, I mean, semantics do matter. For example, in certain countries, it's acceptable to use the word coloured for people of colour. And, you know, people think, you know, when you try to explain this to somebody who uses the word coloured as a catch-all phrase for people of colour, they get very confused why you would have an issue with it, but they don't understand the historical context, or the way in which a word has actually, the etymology of particular words is an issue. You know, for example, if you're if you look at South Africa, in places like Durban, they will use the word coloured for people who are, of Asian heritage or mixed race, and they are treated in a certain way as a result. So there are certain kind of things that you need to be aware of. Even in Australia, they will freely use certain words that here we would consider absolutely unacceptable. So it's also about looking at your context and challenging the way in which words are used and language and the intention behind language and the historical context of language. So all of that does matter in the way that you actually expect society to grow and evolve in understanding the nature of biases and discrimination.
That's actually very powerful. I was first laughing out loud in my mind's eye, because I remember your Goodness Gracious sketch very vividly and how brilliantly, because of your juxtaposing, we you know, people of could learn a lesson from that. And I remember it very, very well. So thank you for reminding the listeners as well. I'm sure we can find it on YouTube or something if you searched. And of course, about empathy. about empathy, about listening, and about language, about, you know, semantics, all of which are equally important. So some really, really powerful good advice, but you know, given with such gentleness and such a care, which I you know, I'm really appreciative of, Mithu, because I know that so many of us would be listening to you and taking away how we can try and manage these biases. What can we do differently? And the taxi driver is saying what he has. It's about getting people to evaluate themselves gently. And that's what you're doing. And that's what makes them so very powerful. Thank you. Thank you so very much, Nitin Soni, for spending this time, for sharing your stories and for talking of unconscious bias with me. Thank you so very much.
Thank you, Smita. Take care.
Thank you for listening to Stories of Unconscious Bias with me, Smita Tharoor. Stay tuned for the next interview in a week's time. You can follow me on Instagram and Twitter for updates on my episodes at Smita Tharoor.